Reverend Walsh, would be in the pulpit this morning. And it's wonderful having you all. Pastor Bill and Barbara in Pennsylvania, being their relatives. Pastor Bill is preaching at his own church today. Maybe he'll save some souls up there. Thank you to everyone who brought food, helped serve, and cleaned up last Sunday at our new Mumble Mansion. We are so blessed to be able to get together for good food and fellowship with our church family. The youth would like to thank you for supporting their bake sale last Sunday. They raised $482.60, but lost a bread for life. That's wonderful. Absolutely. And I tell you what, I bought one of those cakes that they baked. And they were delicious. They enjoyed it. On October 25th, the youth will have a costume party, 6 p.m. at Susan Schultz Home. The band will leave the church at 5:40. Sound like fun. October the 27th, Sam Club meeting. The Christian Fellowship is in a relaxed atmosphere. Come join us for a trip to the Virginia Art and Space Center in Hampton. Lunch at the Center Cosmic Cafe. Cafe serves a variety of quick menu items such as hot dogs, hamburgers, salad, and chicken fingers. Devotion at 9:45 a.m. at the church family boarding cell at 10 a.m. General admission, adults is $18. And if you're going to see the IMAX movie, it's $26. Seniors 65 plus would be $16, and IMAX movie $23. Sometimes I'm glad there's somebody to observe for us. Men, let's hear you. Men, you're invited to sing in the choir on Sunday, No Woman the First. Aaron Cole will be leading you in a familiar song. Please meet in the choir room at 10:45. Are there any other announcements? Anyone else have some announcements? Yeah. Are there any birthdays this week?
Brad's got one this week. Harold.
I'm 18 this week.
18? Yeah. Okay, well, that's like I was 29. Let's sing happy birthday to her.
What am I doing wrong here? selfish.
Call him on that.
What did Jesus teach us about our gifts and what we should do for each other? We should share, shouldn't we? We should share. You have a favorite color?
Red.
Okay. Here's a red one for you. That's right. I'm going to give you all something. Everybody can eat these. You all know these kids better than I can. Okay? Here, just have some and eat them. Please don't drop them on the floor. Just eat them up. They're good. There you go. I'll show you some. There. That's what we should do. We should share, right? Most welcome. Okay? Thank you all. That's right. We'll put our hands up and we should share. Everything we have comes from God, right? Do you have some? Okay, open our door. Baby, put your hand like this, right there. There you go. There you go. All right. You don't let that red one get away because that's his favorite. Did I get you already? All right. That's you, Emma. All right. Nice when we share, isn't it? All right. You want some? Yeah.
I love to tell the story.
How different we are, and things we do. You know, I think God enjoys the best when His children are laughing and being together. I want to read to you from Romans chapter 8, if you have your Bibles. And I'm reading from the New International Version. It's about Paul's letter talking to a church that's really going through a hard time. They're suffering for their faith. And this is what he writes in chapter 8, starting with verse 18. I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory about to be revealed to us. For the creation waits in eager longing for the revealing of the children of God. For the creation was subject to futility, not of its own will, but by the will of the one who subjected it, and hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to decay, and will attain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. We know that the whole creation has been groaning in labor pains until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves. We have the first fruits of the Spirit grown inwardly while we wait for adoption, the redemption of our bodies. For in hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope. For who hopes for what is seen? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. Likewise, the Holy Spirit helps us in our weakness. For we do not know how to pray as we ought, but that very Spirit intercedes with sighs too deep for wounds. And God, who searches the heart, knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. We know that all things work together for good for those who love God and who are called according to His purpose. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Please join me in a spirit of prayer, please. Almighty Father, we gather here this day to offer our prayers, our praise, and our thanks to You for what You're doing in our lives. I pray now, God, that You will just open our minds to Your truth today, and that what is not true will be forgotten, and that You will come into me and I will not be in Your way. For this we pray in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. This is a powerful passage. The Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we don't know often how to pray. That Spirit intercedes for us, deep sighs for us. I think God is saddened with some of the things that are happening in the world today. I know God is a very patient and loving God. If I would have been in charge of the world, I probably would have ended it all by now. But that's God. God loves us so much. And God wants to say to us today, never forget, you are not alone. I am with you. And I'm going through these things with you also. Sometimes in life we do certain things though, and we make choices that sometimes puts us in a different place, doesn't it? And we are in conflict with God sometimes. I think a good definition of sin is this, friends. Anything that blocks us from the will and glory of God can be sin. That blocks us from that. I'm surprised at preachers today that don't talk about sin very much. They've kind of forgotten that. It's just gone somewhere. But it's there, isn't it? There's a song about it, isn't it? On the radio, it's a country western song. It says, oh, I don't know who that was knocking at my door. I didn't know he had blue eyes and wearing blue jeans. It was Satan himself coming to tempt this lady. You and I have been given free will. You and I have been given the ability of brain to make choices for ourselves. And when these choices are not of God's will, they become conflict, don't they? I remember when I was growing up, I went to a Presbyterian church. I went to a non-denominational church. And then when I got in college, I decided that I didn't need to go to church anymore. I had made it, I thought. And I began to make choices that were not very God-desired, as I can say. I hung around with a different crowd, and when I got into college, it just played right into it more and more. I began to do some things that I was not so proud of, and I began to hang around this girl that I thought I really loved. I don't even remember her name. That's what I was talking to you about first. But I went with her for 6 months, and I was in love. I thought she was the one. Well, everything went, I went to the University of Southern Mississippi, and it was a suitcase college. Everybody went home on the weekends except I didn't, because my parents lived in upstate New York at the time. And this girl, she didn't go away either. So we spent a lot of time together. And everything was going very well until I met her fiancé. You can laugh about it now. It was bad. He was a Marine, Fort Walton Beach. You know, the motto of the Marines is this: first to go, last to know. That's the way I felt. I was going. And friends, on this campus, University of Southern Mississippi, I've never noticed this chapel before. And that night, with tears in my eyes, I went into that chapel and I knelt down and I said, God, I'm in trouble. My life is not the way it should be. I've been taught. I've been through catechism. I've been confirmed that I'm away from you. Please help me. That's all I said. Please help me. Send me someone to help me. Well, it was a week later. Vicky came into my life. Vicky, my wife. Be careful what you pray for, Jane. She came in the back door, and I said, who was that woman? I danced with her that night. We were having a party, and I told her I was going to marry her or somebody like her. They broke up. She was dating someone else, and we've been together for 42 years.
Amen.
And she said something to me that was very profound. I don't want to embarrass her. But she said these words to me, ladies, listen to this. If you're going to date me, you're going to go to church. And we did. And I've been going ever since. And here I am now. And we came to Ashland, Virginia, when we graduated, to work at King's Dominion. I told you I was a zoologist. And we attended First Presbyterian Church there in Ashland. With Cam Wallace, and we were youth directors. See, God was really working on me through Vicki, really working on me, changing my heart. It was in 1979 I had a call to ministry. I heard these words from God in a dream one night. You have done what you have wanted to do, Arthur. I have something else for you to do. Now, you got to listen to something like that, you know? And I kept feeling that longing to be in ministry. And I began to substitute and preach a few places. I went to local preacher school. And in 1981, I left King's Dominion, and I attended seminary, Wesley Theological Seminary, and had a church. Didn't know very much about being a pastor. But that congregation reminded me of you all so much. They were very loving and very supportive. And I thought, God, how am I going to make this? I have two children. I'm starting school again. And that church just opened up their heart to Vicki and I. They said, we want to do something to help you more. I think we made $15,000. That's what we made my first year. I went from a $75,000 job to $15,000. They said, we want to pay for your seminary. We want to pay for your travel. We want to pay for your books. Man, was I blessed. And I have never wanted for anything when you turn it over to God. Amen?
Amen.
God just blesses you and takes care of you. Thank God that God is working in this world. You know, God says, I will be with you always. You are never alone. Sometimes the decisions that we make kind of isolate us from each other and God. Sometimes we think we're the only ones that are experiencing sadness or pain or sickness, but we've all been there, haven't we? The church is for the least, the last, and the lost, isn't it? And we all can fit into that category. I know I can. God said, I am with you always. What are the words that he says in Jeremiah? Let me read them to you. If you have the Bible, turn there and listen to them again. Jeremiah 31. The days are coming, says the Lord. I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with the ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt. A covenant which they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days. I will put my law within them. I will write it in their hearts. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another or say to one another, know the Lord, for they shall all know me. For the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord, for I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more. Amen. And the new covenant has been instituted by Jesus Christ, right? He came to institute that covenant. He came to give us salvation, but that covenant is written in our hearts now, isn't it? These are great words. Paul writes in Philippians, I can do all things through him who strengthens me. Who strengthens me. God can do whatever God wants to do. Can't God? And I'm so thankful that God has not given up on any of us. We still have a chance. We still have the ability to do something great. You know, the word Emmanuel, which we're getting ready to celebrate pretty soon with Christmas, means God be with us, doesn't it? God be with us. Matthew 28:20, Jesus is about to leave, ascend into heaven, and he says, remember, I am with you always, even until the end of this age. Those are powerful words. I am with you always. God's promise to be with us then becomes real to us through this church and all churches. The church is the one that represents God, doesn't it? In this society. The church has teaching. The church has preaching, music, prayer, study, koinonia, which means fellowship. And the church is the only institution that offers forgiveness. We are those agents of that change of God. Romans 10:17 says this, brothers and sisters, faith comes by hearing, and what is heard comes through the word of God. That's where our faith comes from, doesn't it? We hear the word of God and we respond to it, don't we? And that one that gives us that ability to respond to that is the Holy Spirit, isn't it? I'm so grateful. I'm so grateful the Holy Spirit is with us. Right now, in this place. It is the Holy Spirit that opens our minds, opens our hearts to the truth. So, you and I then, we have Christian action, response. Faith without works is dead. Not saying that gives you salvation, but we have to have some kind of response, don't we? We have Christian action. We step out trusting that God is there and God is going to do what God says God is going to do. For God is truthful. If you don't hear anything, remember that. God is truthful. And then we are reminded that everything that happens to us and we go through, it is the Holy Spirit that stands with us and helps us through that. This stepping out in trust is an act of faith, isn't it? Again, faith comes by hearing. What is heard comes through the word of God. And all of this is based on a beautiful word called grace. Grace. God's riches at Christ's expense. That's what I like to understand. That. Christ did something for us, and God gives us that riches, eternal salvation through what Christ has done. Friends, I read once, and I don't know who said it, but I like it. Grace is never taken, it's always given. We don't go up and take it. It's God who gives it to us, right? Remember, you and I are somebody to God. You're the most important thing that God has on this earth right now. And everyone, Kenneth, and all those that are suffering, and all those that are going and passing from this life, God is right there with them, opening up the kingdom to them. You're somebody. Didn't I teach you all about that with the thumbs? Have I taught you all that? You remember that? Remember I told you that? Look at your thumbprint. No one else has a thumbprint like that. Remember, you are thumbbody. Remember that. Amen. You are not junk. You are God's very own.
Amen.
A month ago, I was in the Greenville Correctional Center, and you all helped that event happen for me because we were there leading a retreat for 4 days with inmates there. There were 47 inmates there, and I really experienced God's grace. The fellow that stood next to me, his name was Clive, and he told me, you may not remember me, but I'm the fellow that about 3 years ago, I drove my truck into the car, and I stole that ATM. I said, oh, you're the one. He said, I'm very sorry for that. But you had a hand in making that event such a wonderful, God-moving event. You expressed agape. And you know what agape means? That's the unmanifested love of God. No strings attached. You, your youth, made cookies for that event. And I ate a lot of them too because the prison food was terrible. I lost 5 pounds, believe that or not. We had grits with no butter, grits with no salt and pepper. And we had such, I couldn't even see what it was. And they told me, don't eat it, Pastor Art. I'm not. We had meat that you couldn't even recognize. They told me each meal cost 38 cents to make. But I drank a lot of water. I did. But your cookies made a difference. These men told me they cannot believe that a church that doesn't even know us would make cookies for us. Homemade cookies. And your youth did that. And I had the privilege to go around that night after the event was over, and for those that were not attending the weekend, I got to deliver cookies to each cell. It was very moving to me. Their cells weren't half the size of that choir hall. 2 people in there. Toilet right out in the middle. No privacy. Now I know these men have done some things that are not right, but they're children of God. And you made them feel like they were somebody. And I thank you for that. I thank you. As I handed those cookies to people, they said, God bless you. And they were so grateful to have cookies that someone took the time to make. You see, God's grace is never taken. It's always given, isn't it? And I appreciate your prayers for that. Some of you knew that I was on that weekend. I hope that you will remember today that you are never alone. That you are very special to God. And it is by God's grace that we are here today, aren't we? That when you pray, you know that there's a power of release. When you do something for this church, God knows that and rejoices. Whatever you do, keep doing it for God. Because Paul reminds us, right? There's a new beginning. As Jeremiah said, a new covenant. And that covenant is here, right? In our hearts. Jesus came to institute that, and now we are representatives of that new covenant. Vicki and I saw a movie called Utopia. Did any of you see that? Rent it. It's about golf. And Vicki doesn't really like golf, like I do. But it's about a young man, and it's a true story. And he has a breakdown when he's playing golf. He lets his anger overcome him. Throws his clubs in the lake, and probably some of you have done that if you play golf, you know, up a tree or something like that. And so, his dad was his caddy. He says, you need to get your life together, son. So he sends him to Utopia, which is a town in Texas. 343 people live there. That's the population. As he's going into town, he takes his eye off the car, and he runs to a fence and happens to be the man that he's going to see. He tears this man's fence down. And the man who plays the part is Robert Duvall. And he says, well, I'm glad you've come, son. I'm sorry you tore up my fence, but you can work that out. Well, you can pay me to work it through, you know. Well, he goes through and he says, I'm going to get you back on playing golf right. He paints. He says, what does that have to do with golf? So it teaches you stability. Paint goes on, paint goes down. Remember like Miyagi, Karate Kid. Takes him fly fishing, puts him in a boat. He says, what does this have to do with golf? He sits in a boat and he says, if you fall out, you're not keeping your balance. And of course, he fell out a couple times when they caught the fish, but he stood up. And then the third scene, he gave him a ball. And it had SFT on it. He says, what does that mean? He said, you know, God doesn't really care about this game of golf very much, but he cares more about you than anything in the world. And you remember what SFT means. See the love of God. Feel the love of God. And trust the love of God. See, feel, and trust. And that's what I'd say to you. And in the closing of that movie, that guy has to make a putt and either win the match or not. He gets his life together and he puts that ball down and he sees that ball that has SFT on it. And I'm not going to tell you if it wins or not. You'll have to see the movie. But that's a lot of truth there, isn't it? See the love of God. Feel the love of God and trust it. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. We're going to close with a hymn here. It's in your bulletin. It's called 186, Glory Be Glorified.